graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents the Nuclear Bombshell series, The Bionic Bikini, by John Zakour. Narrated by Richard Rowan, with performances by David Coyne, Nanette Savard, Casie Platt, Ken Jackson, Nora Achrati, Yasmin Twazan, Elizabeth Jernigan, Colleen Delany, Eva Wilhelm, Nathanial Perry, Katy Carkuff, Alejandro Ruiz, Chris Genebach, David Jourdan, Tracy Oliveira, Deidra Starnes, Rose Elizabeth Supan, Mort Shelby, Dawn Ursula, Peter Holdway, James Lewis, Evan Casey, Tia Shearer, Elliot Dash, Mary C. Davis, Terence Aselford, Drew Kopas, Christopher Scheeren, and Scott McCormick.
My name is Zachary Nixon Johnson. It's the year 2058, and I'm a PI, a private investigator, the last one left on Earth. You would think being the only freelance private dick in a world with 15 billion Joes and Janes, my life would be pretty exciting. Actually, on most days, my life isn't much different from those average Joes or Janes. These high-tech, mega-information times, everybody is constantly connected to everybody and everything else. DOS. More information is generated in a day than the average person can process in a lifetime. It makes PI work an almost relic of the past. Nearly anybody can perform a nearly infinite number of searches on far more databases than anybody would ever need. Just enter a question into whatever your personal network interface is and poof, less than a second later, you have more answers than any sane person would know what to do with. Folks don't turn to me unless they're looking for something that is particularly tricky or sensitive. You know, the kind of information that involves broken egos, agendas, and bones. In a sense, I'm a search engine with a cool gun up my sleeve. Sure, I've saved the world once or twice, but those cases are the exception. So far, today is like any other regular day. I am sitting in my quaint office on the New Frisco Bay, playing and losing a game of backgammon to my holocomputer assistant, Harv. Since he's wiping the virtual board with me, I'm in no particular hurry to make a move. I sit there admiring my office. Sure, it may be on the Spartan side, but in these hectic times, there's a pure beauty to its sheer simplicity. I have a nice antique desk, not one of those cheap imitation wood copies, mind you. This desk was made from the real thing, back from when they used to cut trees down. My desk doesn't have cool modern features like an ergonomically perfect adjustable surface with full desktop interactive screen and communication devices and voice-activated drawers. Still, it has something else, something better. A smell, a feel, and a raw substance that new desks just don't have. My assistant Carol is constantly reminding me that some tree gave its life to become my desk. She may have a point, but it's a dull one. It's not like I personally hacked the tree down 100 years ago. DOS, back then my father wasn't even a glimmer in my grandfather's eye. My point is, the tree is dead. Long live my desk. I like to tell Carol I think the tree would have wanted it that way, knowing it was with a good home and with someone who really appreciated it. She will then usually sigh and sulk out of my office, back to her little artificial wood desk in the reception area. I sit back a bit on my real leather chair, I won't even go into what Carol thinks about leather, and let my mind continue its stroll down How Lucky I Am Lane. I look around and smile. My only two concessions to the modern world are that my office's sidewalls are giant computer screens and the holographic projector jutting from the ceiling. Outside of those, my office looks remarkably like any PI office from those old 2D detective movies. I take pride in that. I swing around and gaze out the projectile-proof glass bay window behind my desk overlooking the bay. What was once the hustle and bustle of a transport center has been replaced with the hustle and bustle of a tourist attraction. I wonder what it must have been like a mere 100 years ago. before teleporters and bots replaced boats and dock workers. Back then, this street would have been teeming with working people wishing for a vacation, not people vacationing looking for a little action. Funny, we have more leisure time now, but it seems that we fill that time with such chaos in an attempt to do it all, we actually get very little done. I'm not sure if we're any better off than our less connected ancestors. After all, they always look so happy on all those old shows.
Come on, Zach. Roll the dice. I am going to win again. This will mark my 10th victory in the last 11 games.
I look at Harv and smile, just to get on his circuits a bit. Despite the fact that he is a hologram and can appear in any form he wants, Harv always chooses the same basic form. I call it his academic scholar meets a prim and proper snooty butler look. At least how Harv thinks such a person should look, if they had actually existed. He has a touch of gray running through his ever-so-slightly receding hairline, his eyes are cold and unwavering, his nose is just long enough for him to look down on me with. He looks far too flawless to achieve that perfect human look he is trying to present, even without the little hologram glow and shimmer around him. Any child can tell he isn't human.
Really, Harv, you're the most sophisticated hologram in the world. It worries me that you seem to thrive at beating me at backgammon.
I would worry also if I wasn't constantly doing at least a million other things while I'm thrashing you. For instance, I am currently updating your stock portfolio. Your worth has just increased 0.1345%.
Thanks.
Just because my main logic chip is wired to your little brain doesn't mean I am limited to just assisting you. I am also helping my creator, the esteemed Dr. Randy Poole, make some financial calculations for a shrink ray he's working on. Plus, I am on Carol's jog with her, keeping track of her time and distance and heart rate. I am also—
I get the message. I glanced over Randy's promotional material. You, and I quote, bring multi-hologram tasking to the next level.
Having Harv connected to my brain via my optic nerve, which hurt like DOS, I might add, does give me certain advantages. Harv can feed me almost any information I need while making it literally for my eyes only. I can project holograms from my eyepiece, creating all sorts of interesting effects. Harv has the ability to interface with my body's chemicals and the special body Under Armour I wear, allowing me to accomplish feats most people couldn't dream of doing on their best days. The catch is, Harv certainly isn't just a machine. He's a living, self-aware being, and he has the court records to prove it. He is programmed to be helpful and informative, but he's also programmed to go beyond his programming. Where that will eventually take him, humanity, and myself is anybody's guess, which scares me at times. After all, I'm sharing my brain with another intelligence, a very chatty one at that. I'm never sure if I'm using Harv, Harv is using me, or if we're using each other. Randy insists that we have a gestalt relationship. Our whole is greater than the sum of our parts. Randy, though, is a typical scientist, putting his innovations in front of my aggravations.
You're thinking about our interface again?
Maybe.
Zach, I've told you this 312 times. The reason why my creator, the esteemed Dr. Randy Poole, implanted my main logic chip in you is because he figured that you could use my services and also protect me from his competitors. You are not a lab rat. A beta tester, perhaps. But that is a noble profession. You should be proud.
Have you ever noticed that you always refer to Randy as the esteemed Dr. Randy Poole?
Of course I noticed. I notice everything. For instance, right now I notice you are trying to delay the inevitable. My victory over you. Perhaps you should consider taking up a new game. Something like checkers or virtual Go Fish.
Perhaps I should consider getting another holo assistant. I kind of miss my old Bob model.
The Bob model? Ugh. The Bob model could barely defeat two grandmasters in chess and simulate chewing gum at the same time.
I smile. I may be only a mere human, but at times, I really know how to rattle Harv's chips.
Suddenly, our pseudo-friendly game is broken up. Two not very menacing-looking bots roll from the reception area into my office. I always get the strangest visitors when Carol is on her lunch break run.
Greetings, Zachary Nixon Johnson. We have come to test you.
I give the bots the once-over. They certainly don't look like much. Kind of like some kid had slapped a couple of antique TVs on top of a couple of little roller bases and attached a few claws to them, all while watching MHV. Of course, this could be a deception meant to put me off guard. They look quite harmless. But then again, so does the deadly vampire bunny of Gladian 3.
The test is actually quite simple for a carbon. One of us is programmed to always tell the truth and to be helpful. To be, so to speak, your best bud. The other is programmed always to lie and kill you. To be your worst nightmare. You may ask us one question. If after that question you can deduce which one of us is which, the one sent to kill you will not.
Interesting challenge.
Yes, we think so.
Big electronic smiles displayed across their screens. Interesting challenge. The problem is, your problem isn't all that challenging when the person you're challenging... I pause for a second, letting them think I'm building up the suspense. Instead, I'm actually moving my wrist in just the right way that makes my Colt 45,000 pop up my sleeve and into my hand. It's packing a really cool gun. I show the gun to the bots to give them just long enough to compute the folly of their ways. I hate tests, especially those that involve killer bots, algebra, or stool samples. I look up and see an older-looking man walking in from the reception area. I assume they were yours.
Yes, they were. Mind if I sit?
The man motions to the chair next to my desk. What stops me from blowing you away?
You are one of the good guys, Mr. Johnson. I know you don't kill Carbons.
Okay, so what stops me from winging you in the leg?
Nothing. Except if you do, you will lose a job. A very high-paying job.
All right. You've piqued my interest. I motion for him to sit down. This guy has the body of an out-of-shape sloth, so I figure he's most likely no threat to me. I pop my gun back up my sleeve and sit down behind the desk. How can I help you?
I need you to find somebody for me.
I certainly hope there's more to this story.
Yes. Yes, of course.
He tries to play it cool, only I can tell having my gun pointing at him has unnerved him more than he wants to let on. He's more accustomed to facing computer screens than gun barrels. Well, let's hear it.
My name is Dr. Hank Blake. I'm a senior VP, level 5, class 10, in charge of research for H-Tech. One of my employees, Dr. Fred Waters, has not shown up for work in a week. He doesn't respond to our email or vid calls. We want you to find him.
Why don't you use your own security people to find him?
Because they are security people, not seek and find people. If you can successfully track him down, we will pay you 50,000 credits. The pay will be reduced by 5,000 credits every day it takes you, down to a minimum of 10,000 credits.
What kind of 411 can you give me on Waters?
The 4 what what?
The 411 is Zach's quaint way of saying information.
Oh. Well, most of what he was working on is, of course, classified. But you can have access to everything that is in our employee get-to-know-ya database.
Fine. I shall access the database. What is your visitor's access passphrase?
We have no passphrase.
You have no passphrase?
No, no. Our passphrase is, we have no passphrase.
I knew that. Information is coming up now.
A hollow picture of Waters appears in the middle of the room. He's not much to look at. He may be a young-looking 60, but he's more likely an old-looking 40-something. He's average height, pretty much bald, and his body has hopefully seen better days. He makes the McPillsbury Hollow Doughboy look like a macho fighting machine. Words scroll across the image. Favorite color, white. Turn-ons, pepperoni. Turn-offs, anchovies. Degrees, MD, new Harvard PhD, new MIT. That's it. Doc, you don't really have much there.
We don't like to pry into our employees' lives.
You don't even have his address.
We never thought it would be important to know where our employees actually live.
So that's it? You just want me to find him?
Yes, that sums it up nicely.
Why?
The why is not important.
It is to me. My knowing why you want him so badly will give me insight into him.
We owe him some back pay.
I look at him. He looks at me. Come on, Doc. I know H-Tech. They aren't known for their generosity.
Okay. He took some office supplies. We want them back.
He took 50,000 credits worth of office supplies?
No, of course not. But we have hundreds of thousands of employees. If they each took even a little, we would lose a fortune. So, we want to make an example out of him.
They may never say this on HV, but information is the PI's most powerful weapon. Right now, I'm not even pecking enough heat to stop a half-crazed ant with an attitude. I need more to go on. It is apparent, though, that information is on a need-to-know basis, and as far as Blake is concerned, I have no need. I don't want to pass up a good-paying job, but I don't want to go rushing in blindly either. Blind PIs quickly become dead PIs. I need an added edge.
I'm back from my run, Dio!
I smile. My edge is here, and what an edge she is. Glistening with sweat and wearing a pink jogging halter and shorts so short they should come with a warning for men with weak hearts. Carol may look like your beautiful Latina co-ed, but she's so much more. A Class 1 Level 6 Psi, one of the most powerful on the planet. If she's in the right mood, there aren't many people's minds she can't melt like new improved silly putty on a hot day.
Need me for anything before I hit the shower?
Come into the office, Inanno. I need you to run a mind scan on a client. Make sure his story is legit. I look over to Blake. Do you mind?
No, not at all. I have a very strong mind. I doubt she'll get anything out of me.
Carol walks into the room. She towels a bit of sweat off her forehead and smiles at the good doctor. She loves being challenged. He has thrown down the gauntlet, and she's gonna pick it up and smack him in the face with it.
So, you have a strong mind, do you?
Yes, I do.
He crosses his arms to further strengthen his resolve. But by egging her on, he's a dead man talking. He just doesn't know it, and he won't until it's too late. To make matters worse, he has locked eyes with her. A mistake for any man, even if she wasn't a Psy.
Okay, Senor Strong Mind. Stand on one leg, jump up and down, and flap your arms while clucking like a little chicken.
Immediately, Dr. Blake becomes Dr. Ready for Shake and Bake. He jumps up and down on one leg, frantically flapping his arms, trying fruitlessly to fly.
Oh, yes. You have quite a strong mind, senor.
Carol turns to me.
His mind is mine.
Well, the chicken thing is the virtual camp PJs and all. I need him to talk. In English, please. Carol brings her attention back to Blake.
You can stop jumping and clucking now. You will answer all questions completely and to the best of your knowledge.
Yes, master.
You can speak only the truth.
I'm a scientist. I only care about the truth. Oh, and the funding.
Why don't you have Waters' address?
Because he erased it, along with much other pertinent information from our database.
What's his field of specialty?
He was a virus expert, both organic and electronic, and their hybrids.
Why do you want to find him?
We are afraid his actions will cause us to be liable for a very, very big lawsuit.
So, what was he working on when he went AWOL?
He was... Tweet! Tweet!
Uh-oh, looks like I hit him a little bit too hard. If I don't bring him out soon, he's going to think he's a bird for months.
Well, snap him out of it, please. Turning clients into bird brains has got to be bad for repeat business.
Tia Electra is right. You can be such a warrior sometimes.
I glare at her. She grins back.
When I snap my fingers, you will remember nothing of this.
Blake snaps back to what for him passes as normal.
See? I tell you it was impossible to control.
He turns to me.
Will you take the case?
Sure, why not? I think I can find space on my e-calendar.
Great. Net with me when you track him down, and then my people will do the rest.
He leaves the room, flapping his arms like they were wings.
That will probably wear off pretty soon.
Okay. Thanks, you've been a big help.
Just remember this the next time I ask for a raise. Now, if you don't mind, there's a shower with my name on it.
Take your time.
I plan to.
Carol heads out of the room to the private bathroom beside my office. I sit down behind my desk and kick my legs up. This is going to take a little thinking. No reason why I shouldn't be comfortable.
Okay, so what's our first move?
I'm not sure yet. I put my arms behind my head.
Great. I guess I was just foolish for thinking we'd be able to get the maximum payment for this job.
What's this wee business? You're a hologram, a collection of algorithms and rays of heavy light. You got no need for credits.
True, but I do enjoy buying things vicariously through you.
Okay, since I don't want to disappoint you, scan all known information bases for any reference to Waters.
Done. I scanned over 100 billion records with not even a mention of him. Whoever is covering this up is very good. Would you like me to bribe a computer or two?
Not yet. First, let's try some good old-fashioned Q&A. Net me with Electra.
She is scheduled to begin an operation in 1 minute and 20 seconds.
Just do it, Harv. This won't take much time. A communicator window zooms open on my left wall screen. A picture of my fiancée, Electra, in the operating room fades in. I swear, even covered head to toe in surgical scrubs, a blind man could tell she was beautiful. She has long, dark, yet somehow fiery hair that matches her sizzling personality. Her coffee-brown eyes can either melt you or look right through you, depending on her mood. She radiates full-brown Latina pizzazz. According to Harp, the fact that she's my girlfriend is one of the few conundrums known to modern man that even he can't solve. I've never been one to question luck. Electra looks up at her wall screen and smiles.
What's up, mi amor?
Have you ever heard of a Dr. Fred Waters?
Si. He's an expert on man-made viruses. I went to one of his seminars once. It was very interesting and a bit strange.
Strange? How so?
Most people have donuts and soy coffee at these things. He had pizza. Now, if you don't mind, I have an immune system transplant to start.
Fine, thanks. Dinner's on me tonight.
Yummy. I guess that means we'll be going to Mac BK again.
Witty, charming, and a kickboxer to boot. I still have absolutely no idea what she sees in you.
I think she just loves me for my computer.
Yes, that would make sense.
Bring up Randy now. I want to see what our favorite mad scientist has to say about all this. I look at my right wall screen. There is Dr. Randy Poole working away intently on something or other.
Oh, hi, Zach. What do you need now? Did you read my latest e-note about the firmware update to your gun? I made it so it can now be magnetized or tracked to the iron molecules in your body.
Thanks, Randy. I need to pick your brain.
Well, talk fast. I'm right in the middle of perfecting this new minimizing ray that will revolutionize the way we store physical objects. I don't want to have another one of those nasty little incidents. Half of New Frisco still hasn't forgiven me over my last minor miscalculation. So they smelled like sulfur for a few days. What crybabies. Progress is never easy and flawless. If it was, everybody would want to go into the sciences.
Randy pauses for a minute to collect his thoughts.
Did you want something?
What do you know about Dr. Fred Waters?
He was in my scientist anti-gravity racquetball league for a while. I played him a couple of times. Nice guy. Kinda geeky, though. He's also pretty specialized. He only likes to design viruses.
Have any idea where he lives?
Sorry, Zach. That never came up in conversation.
Anything unusual about him?
Only thing I can remember about him is that at our lunches after the games, he would always have pizza teleported in. Now, if you don't mind, I have science to attend to. I'm working on a game-changing project. Something so cool and sexy.
Of course you are, Randy. Thanks for your help. Well, I think I can see a pattern here. Scan all pizza delivery places and try to find reference to our guy.
Okay, I'm scanning.
A series of holographic numbers appear above his head.
This is weird.
The numbers change to a giant question mark. What?
One of these pizza joints has transactions that have been encrypted with a 1,000-bit key, which is very strange.
Holographic prison bars form around Harv. I have to give him credit. He really does have a flair for the dramatic.
Okay, this might take a while, maybe even a full second. Do you want me to bribe one of the system's people for a key to unlock the encryption? Then I can get the address and names of whom they are delivering to.
The prison bars melt away. The question marks morph into little dancing dollar signs. What's the name of the pizza joint?
Pizza, 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 with 3 exclamation marks.
Original. He probably paid some consulting firm big credits to come up with that.
If you would like, I could look up who they used. Maybe they could come up with a catchy new logo for you.
I'm not sure if he knows I was being ironic and is just being ironic back at me, but I'm pretty certain he does and he is, so I ignore him. Scan their employee roster. See if anybody has any connection to Waters. Harv's eyes start blinking. They don't have to, he just makes them do that to let me know he's processing.
Well, I'll be a Pentium's uncle.
Yeah?
Well, their employee database was also locked, which I found weird, so I tapped into their security camera's database and did a facial recognition of all their employees.
A picture of an older brick building appears in the middle of the room.
This is Vinny Vinny, the owner of Pizza Pizza Pizza.
Okay, go on, Harv.
Vinny Vinny is first cousins with Dr. Waters. I only figured it out because they referred to each other in a 20-year-old face and body book page.
Nice work, Harv. What's the address?
You mean their actual street address, or their email or web address?
Street. A picture of an older brick building appears in the middle of the room.
They aren't too far from here. It's located in Little New Italy, at 777.25 North Beach.
Let's do some really old-fashioned boots-on-the-ground detective work. Harv stares at me. Let's go to Pizza Pizza Pizza! Talk to Cousin Vinny in person.
Ah, the personal approach.
Yep.
How quaint.
Harv is a little apprehensive as we walk out of my office toward my beautiful, antique, 1969 cherry red Mustang. What's wrong, Harv?
You know, Carol should be done with her shower in 2 minutes and 22 seconds.
Harv, it's a bit disturbing that you know that. Are you watching her? Harv stops walking and crosses his arms, glaring at me defiantly.
I am watching her no more than I monitor every other event going on around me. I only know when she'll be done because I performed a simulation based on the time she normally takes to shower, the amount of sweat on her body, and current water usage.
Sure you did. I start moving toward my car again. Please tell Carol where we're going so she can watch The Office. Harv disappears, then appears beside me, broadcasting himself from my PiPod, personal information and communication device, that I wear around my wrist.
That's my point. Shouldn't we be bringing Carol with us? Her abilities could be a great help in examining the perp.
I stop walking next to my car and look at Harv. First off, I'm impressed with your use of the word perp.
I knew you'd like that.
But this Cousin Vinny isn't a perp. He's a guy we're questioning to help us find the perp.
Zach, in your world, everybody is a potential perp. You've been attacked lecturing at a super senior's home. Over pudding.
True, but this will be a crowded restaurant. Carol's powers work best one-on-one, when she doesn't have a lot of mental white noise to filter out.
I'll give you that one. I was just afraid you considered this an affront to your PI manhood.
I press a button on my Pi Pod. The force field around the car disappears. Can't be too careful when you're a guy who gets attacked over pudding. Harve struck a bit of a nerve, even though I wouldn't admit it. Sometimes I do like to prove I can still function as a PI without all the tech and superpower tools I have at my disposal. I decide not to dwell too much on it. Driving my cherry red Mustang is always a pleasure. Sure, the car is nearly 100 years old, but it still handles like a dream. They made things to last back in the old days. These days, almost everyone else usually uses computer-driven cars or public hovercrafts. Or worse yet, people teleport from place to place. I don't despise computer-driven cars. I know computers are way better drivers than 99.999% of the human population. Computers don't get distracted by phone calls and texts and such. I am not a fan of teleporting. There are some people who don't like it because it's alien technology.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.